Ladies and gentlemen, from New York City, Gary Moore.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Hello, William Wendell. Over there. Hi, you. Nice to see you. Topic number one for today is survival. And I'm not talking about just the survival of our daily slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, but in this case, surviving an airplane crash in sub-freezing temperatures in the wilds of the Rocky Mountains. We'll find out about that as soon as we say hello to our panel here on To Tell the Truth. And here, Bill Cullen. Kitty Carlisle. And Peggy Cass.
I sit where I'm supposed to.
Gene comes out here with his hand tied. I can only say all the safer, Miss Carlisle and Miss Cass. Dr. Linus Pauling. Dr. Linus Pauling states that nothing but nothing is quite as good for you as vitamin C.
Right.
I agree. Here.
I have with me three very vital C's: Carlisle, Cass, and Cullen.
Oh, lovely.
Which is fortunate, because if what I needed was vitamin G, I would have Carlisle, Gullen, and Gas. Or if you don't like that, if there's such a thing as vitamin F, S, I would...
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
We're a little late, folks. Good night.
If I had vitamin S, then what I would have is Carlisle, Sullen, and Sad.
Yeah.
So, I bless my C's. Meanwhile, we have a gentleman who is a tonic for any show.
Oh, boy.
Mr. Gene Rayburn, or whatever his name is.
That's it. Saber. Thank you. Come on now, Gary. Get it together.
Yes, come on,
let's, come on, Gary. Let's stop fooling.
This
is a serious show.
I'm enjoying myself. That's all. Right now, let us meet ourselves an extremely lucky lady.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Sue Booker.
Number two.
My name is Sue Booker.
Number three.
My name is Sue Booker.
And here is the story of survival of Sue Booker. She says, I, Sue Booker, have a story of survival to tell. And here it is. My husband and I were in a private plane when we lost visibility during a snowstorm. We crashed into a mountainside and hit a tree stump, which flipped the plane onto its back. Huddled inside the crashed plane, we were cold, hungry, and extremely frustrated. We could see the search planes, but they couldn't see us. Finally, on makeshift snowshoes, we started down the mountain. Luckily, we ran into two men who led us to safety, and our ordeal was over. We had survived a plane crash, 5 days in the sub-freezing temperature of the Rocky Mountains, and miraculously, neither of us had a scratch. Signed, Sue Booker. And there will be questions and answers from the panel and contestants as soon as we survive this, like so.
This week in game show history, Concentration debuts in the primetime hour with host Jack Barry. The Price is Right expands to an hour, debuting the Showcase Showdown Wheel. And Match Game teams with Hollywood Squares, forming an hour of crazy celebrity answers.
Now, none of you will have forgotten, I'm sure, that across from us are three lucky ladies, all of whom claim to be Sue Booker, who survived for 5 days in sub-freezing temperatures after her plane crashed in the Rocky Mountains. And Bill Cullen, why don't you lead the search party for the right one?
Number two, where was the mountain?
It was in the Canadian Rockies.
Number one, who was flying the airplane?
My husband.
Well, now, staying with you on that answer, he did a pretty good job. And I mean that seriously, because you lose visibility and you go into the mountainside. So, in his estimation, and yours and everyone else's, I suppose, he did pretty good in getting it down at all. Is that right?
I think so.
Did you have one of those automatic rescue devices aboard the airplane number 3?
Yes, we did, but he tested it when we started to lose visibility and it was not functioning.
Number 2, does that same story go with you?
Yes, it does.
What is that automatic rescue device, number 2?
I don't know. I'm not the pilot.
Oh. Number 1, do you know what that automatic rescue thing was that he tested and didn't work?
What it's called?
Yeah.
Emergency transmitter.
Thank you, number 1.
And we've got ourselves a buzzer. We're going to Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you. Well, number 3, that's very ingenious. What did you make the makeshift snowshoes out of?
Well, we took the seats apart and used the seat belts to strap them onto our feet and part of the seating. The wire part.
Thank you. And what did you have on in the way of clothes to paddle down this mountainside in a blizzard? Number 2.
Very little. We just come from Calgary, and it was quite warm when we left there.
And number 1, how long was it before you found the other people who helped you to civilization?
We were 5 days total.
No, I mean, how long after you got out of the plane?
Oh, 2 days.
2 days with no warm clothes?
Right.
Number 2, no frostbitten feet? No frostbitten fingers?
Nothing, no.
Nose? Well, number 3, did you pray a lot?
Uh-huh. There we go, friends. We have got a buzzer, and we're going to Gene Rayburn.
Thank you. Number 1, what month of the year did this occur?
September.
In September?
The end of
September. What, now, and did your husband own the plane, number 1?
No.
Number 2, who owned the plane?
It was belonged to a friend of ours.
Yes. And number 3, I take it your husband has got many hours as a pilot?
He's been flying about a year.
And have you been flying with him a lot?
Not too much.
Yeah. Number 2, who pre-flighted the aircraft? Who examined it? You know, that's a procedure you have to do by law before you take off. Somebody's got to inspect it.
Well, from the airport we took off from, there was just one mechanic.
And number 1, what was the depth of the snow?
About 2 feet.
And do you agree with number 2?
Oh, tough. I'm sorry about that. We're going to Peggy.
Number 3, was your friend that owned the plane upset?
Yes, they were glad that we were safe, but it's a lot of money involved. The plane was
totaled. Well, was it insured?
No.
Oh, my. Are you going to have to buy them a new plane?
It's under litigation right now.
Oh, then you're not best friends anymore, I'll bet you. Okay. Number 2, was it an instrument failure or just the fact that you couldn't see?
It was the fact that we couldn't see. It was a blinding snowstorm.
Thank you. Now, number 1, I understand that you could tie the snowshoes on with the seatbelts, but what did you use for the webbing and the frames?
The seats themselves, the material that were on the seats.
You mean you went clonking around in two airplane seats on your feet? I just think you would have been better off with just your shoes. No?
Answer apparently is no. In any event, we got ourselves a bell. And when we get the bell, you know what that means? That means no more questions, but time for balloting. And so ballot we must, friends. Is it a number 1? Or is it survivor number 2? Or is it survivor number 3? In any event, what we do is we pay $50 to the group for each wrong vote. They get $500 in case nobody comes up with the right survivor. Bill Cullen starts.
You know, I voted for number 3 on the basis of what I think is a terribly true answer or a gross lie. When Jean asked if he was an experienced pilot, she said, oh, yeah, he's been flying about a year now. I like that answer so much. Number 3, you have my vote no matter what.
There you go. You've got a 3 showing, and we go on, please, to Kitty.
Well, I like number 1 because she seemed to know what that device was called, and that's a special kind of thing, so I thought she was the real one.
All right. We got him on both ends. Here comes Flyer Gene Rayburn.
Well, I'm hoping it's going to be number 1. I voted for her, and I am hoping that if she is the one, she's going to give us a demonstration of walking around here with her big floppy snowshoes there.
All right, so we got a pair of ones and a 3, and here comes Peggy.
Well, I didn't vote for those 2.
You did?
I voted for the number 2 because she said it was it sort of reprimanded me. It was a blinding snowstorm, and it could have happened to anyone.
Yes, yes.
Yeah,
she was defensive.
Attitude. Yeah. There we go. Votes are all in, friends. Will the real Sue Booker please stand up? Hello, Sue. Anytime we get the vote spread around, we've got a good team over there. Number two, tell me about yourself. What is your real name? What do you do?
My name is Josette Belcourt, and I'm an executive secretary with the foreign government here in New York City.
Nice to have you. And number three, can you tell me about you, please?
My name is Lucy Dane, and I'm a paralegal with Lampf, Plevelipkind, and Prupis.
Ah. Well, Sue Booker, in more ways than one, it's a delight to have met you and have you with us today.
Thank you.
And say hello to your husband. Glad about him, too. And don't worry about your friends. You'll make up. Take care now, and thank you all. Yeah.
Those commercials haunt you no longer. Rest assured, we now return.
Now keep your eyes glued to the screen as we introduce three losers in the Mr. America contest.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Cortland Hull.
Number two.
My name is Cortland Hull.
Number three.
My name is Cortland Hull.
And hang on to every word of Cortland Hull's monstrous message. I, Cortland Hull, am a monster buff. I have created the Witch's Dungeon, a private museum of moviedom's meanest and maddest monsters. In it, you can see realistic life-size figures of such notorious nasties as Dr. Frankenstein's monster, as originally portrayed by the inimitable Boris Karloff. This is a representation of Lon Chaney Sr. in one of his unforgettable characterizations, The Phantom of the Opera. And here is the patron saint of my museum, an original character I call Zenobia the Witch, stirring up your basic witch's brew.
Oh, it's so nasty.
And I know you'll all recognize the creature from the Black Lagoon, one of the first memorable science fiction horror movies. And here is the mummy Karras from the movie The Mummy's Tomb. He was played by Lon Chaney Jr. And another classic Lon Chaney Jr. characterization was the Wolfman.
Quiet, Peg.
And here is the Mole Man, a brilliant creation by makeup artist Bud Westmore for the movie The Mole People. One of my featured creatures is Bela Lugosi as Count Dracula, with his shiny plastered hair and his fresh blood-red lips. In addition to creating monsters, I give lectures at various colleges. My subject, what else? Dracula, werewolves, and children of the night. Signed, Cortland Hull. And before we start the questioning, I just want you to know that this ring that I'm wearing here is a real collector's item. It was once worn by Bela Lugosi in one of his celebrated portrayals of Count Dracula. Now, Peggy Katz, are you a monster buff?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I do love monsters. Number two, what are you made up as?
This is a character that Lon Chaney Sr. did in The Phantom of the Opera, The Red Death.
Now, number three, who played the lead in I Was a Teenage Werewolf?
It was Lon Chaney Jr.
Thank you. And number one, do you know where Dracula came from?
Transylvania.
Thank you. And number three, not bad. Number three, what was Boris Karloff's real name?
Parker.
Thank you. And number two, how long did it take? Lon Chaney didn't wear a mask like that, did he?
In one part of the movie, he came down the staircase to spy
Paris
on
opera,
the opera
right.
singer. Yeah.
Oh. Well, now, number one, how long would it take Lon Chaney to do his makeup for The Hunchback of Notre Dame?
Approximately 3 hours.
And did he do his own makeup?
Yes, he did.
Thank you.
And that takes us on down to Bill Cullen, please.
You know what I like best?
What?
It was a very nice gesture on the producer's part. During the time you were reading that statement, they panned shots and took pictures of people in the audience. Mm-hmm. I thought that was really... Not one ghoul waved, you know. Now, number three, where is this collection gathered?
Kensington, California.
Now, number one, does one pay admission in order to see this?
Yes.
And where is yours, number one?
In Virginia Beach, Virginia.
Number two, how many things are there in all? How many people are there in all in this museum?
There are 13 characters.
And that's the whole bit?
Well, as you go through, there's soundtracks from each character's motion picture.
Uh-huh. Number two, you talk without moving your mouth.
I'm really smiling.
He does that better than Edgar Bergen ever did, Gary.
We got a buzzer, and then let's go to Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you. Number one, what are you made up as?
Count Dracula.
And did you do your own makeup?
Yes, I did.
Number two, did we find out where your museum is?
No, it's in Bristol, Connecticut.
In Bristol?
Bristol.
In
Sorry,
it's a little hard. Yes, in Bristol,
problem.
I see. number three, did you...
see my dentist.
Yeah, your dentures don't fit.
Yeah,
I can see that. Number three, did you learn how to do this from Madame Tussaud, or do you make these models yourself?
I make...
Number three, excuse me.
Design the costumes, I don't make them.
Oh, you design them.
Yes.
And number two, do you make the models? I mean, do you do the heads so they look like what they're supposed to?
Most all of them. A few of them I have been able to obtain the original life masks of the characters that were the actors that played the parts.
I see. Number one, do you charge admission to this museum?
Yes, merely 50 cents.
And lots of people come?
Yes, averaging 2,000 a year.
That's not bad.
And that takes us to Mr. Gene Rayburn.
Number one, tell us, what is it like to be dead, to be really dead? What is it like? Tell us.
It's absolutely wonderful.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Number one, how come your hair is, on the real Count Dracula, his hair is dark. Yours is, you touch up your hair a little bit?
Yeah, this is my own creation.
Oh, I
decided I would do
your
something
different. Your interpretation, yeah.
Yes.
Number three, I should like to ask you to say the word antipasto. But the rules do not permit, so I shall say it for you. Antipasto.
What's that from? Number three, how many pictures did Frankenstein do?
I'm sorry, Gene.
Too many for you.
We learned a lot, but the bells rang. And when the bell rings, it rings for us all, and you must ballot. And who do you think? Is it ghoul number one, ghoul number two, or ghoul number three?
Now, Buzzer brings you Better Living Through Advertising. Vintage game shows with cool commercials left in. Tonight, starting at 4, only on Buzzer.
Has an opinion, what?
Well, I ruled out number three because Michael Landon was the teenage werewolf, I think. And also, I think Frankenstein's name was Harry Platt. Harry Pratt, that was the name of
Boris Karloff.
You ask about Lon Chaney.
No, well, the thing is, I did see that number two's costume is absolutely accurate. And number one, if you only have 2,000 people and it's only and it's 50 cents a head, you only get by on $1,000 a year. I don't think you can make it, so I voted for two.
All right, so we have a two showing and we're going down to Bill Cullen.
This group looks like Goodson Todman and their lawyer, doesn't it? Beyond that, I will not identify. You know, Peggy is absolutely right about the mistakes number three made, and I wish you had said something a little sooner because I already voted for it. But use it in good health, number three. It's not
so,
my day.
So there you go. You don't believe in it, but you voted for him, and he's got a two and a three and a kitty.
Well, I voted for number one. It's quite true that he doesn't make much money in his museum, but I figured he was independently wealthy. He looks terribly rich.
You would think that.
And so, great side. Everybody has got one. Gene Rayburn, where are you going?
I will break the tie.
You do that good.
I am voting for number one because...
Because?
His monsters steal for him. And that's how he can live on $1,000 a year.
Ha, ha, ha.
Well, in any event, the votes are all in, so at this juncture will the real Cortland Hull please levitate.
Cortland Hull!
And beneath the mask, a nice looking mask. Very good. Thank you, Cortland. And before we leave you, Cortland, you do design these costumes yourself.
Yes, all three of are my costumes, and I did the makeup
on
the other
two
films.
You did the makeup on them as well. Magnificent job. Let's find out who we all are. Number one, you should be an actor. I don't know what you... Well, tell us what your real name is and what you do.
My name is Greg Breland, and I'm a professional hot dog skier.
Well, you're great. Really great. And Fu Manchu's cousin down on the end there, number three. What is your real name and what do you do?
My name is Steve Gould, and I'm a graduate student in advertising at Baruch College.
Good to have you here. Gordon, I believe we did establish that your museum is in Bristol, Connecticut, is
yes.
it not?
Yes, yeah.
Not too far from where I live. I'll drop by and scare myself to death.
You certainly should sometime.
Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you, gentlemen, as well. You know, I found it fascinating to meet those folks who survived the crash of a private plane, which never happened to me, but I was in a crash on a commercial plane one time, and I must say the crew was simply magnificent. I was pinned there, absolutely motionless, under my seat, couldn't move at all, and the stewardess rushed right over to me immediately, and she asked me if I wanted Time, Newsweek, or Reader's Digest.
Very good, good.
Yeah. And, of course, they did have first aid. It was free to the people in first class. It was a minor charge for people in economy. But it was a splendid experience, and I was proud. And we'll see you next time around.
In addition to the cash awards, our first state of challenges will receive Sarah Coventry, the exclusive fashion jewelry that you can buy from a friend. Sarah Coventry, the jewelry with know-how. My second team will receive Turtle Wax, the world's largest selling liquid car wax. Clean polishes, protects them on easy operation. Turtle Wax with a hard shell finish. Monster film furnished by WTNH-TV, New Haven, Connecticut. This is Bill Wendell speaking for To Tell the Truth. Amar Goodson, Bill Todman Productions.